Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. There has been so much talk recently about net zero by 2050. Most of the big economies have targets by now on or around that date, and there have been roadmaps released, most notably the recent one from the IEA. I do have to admit that I have not always been focused on our energy transition endgame, getting all the way to zero. And in fact, I sometimes feel like focusing too much on that word zero causes as many problems as it solves, as it immediately seems to focus our attention on the very hardest, most expensive, and most inconvenient parts of the energy transition at the expense of all the like really cheap and easy things that we could be doing right now. I spent the last couple of decades focused mostly on clean electricity and more recently on other parts of the energy sector. Always working on what I believe is the lowest hanging fruit, the easiest sectors that we can eliminate emissions from. Of course, I'm aware that there are emissions from other sectors like agriculture and land use, but since we still have so much work to do on the energy side, I've been kind of putting the other stuff in my mental back burner. But recently, now that everyone is talking about net zero by 2050, it's starting to hit home that we can't get to zero without taking every source of emissions into account. And given that we need to get to carbon neutrality by 2050, just 3 decades from now, we're gonna need a plan for all of it, not just the easy parts. In this video, I'm gonna talk to my friend and fellow YouTuber, ClimateAdam. Adam is a climate scientist, an atmospheric physicist to be exact, with a PhD in that from Oxford University. In their YouTube channel, they talk about climate science and also some of the related politics. And it's my favorite climate science channel because it covers the topics in a scientifically accurate way, but also with a silly sense of humor that I really love. We made a video together on ClimateAdam about hydrogen technologies. So take a look at that one too. So while I had the attention of a climate scientist, I used the opportunity to ask Adam every question that I have about the concept of net zero by 2050. I mean, it sounds simple enough, but when I really started thinking about it, I realized I had questions about every word in that short phrase. So net, I understand the concept of net zero for like a company or a city or a country where you can buy offsets from somewhere else. But what does net mean when we're talking about global warming? I mean, are we planning to send CO2 into space or something? Then zero, what actually counts in our total? I mean, I get that nature doesn't count, but then why does planting trees count? I mean, trees are nature. And bison are part of nature, so their emissions don't count, but cows' emissions do. And finally, by 2050, where does that number come from? And what does it assume? Does it matter how we get there? So net zero by 2050 isn't as simple a concept as I would expect for a four-word phrase. But lucky for me, Adam was happy to help. Okay, so first question is what do we mean by net zero?
I think everyone understands what zero means, which is just nothing. It means no emissions. So when we talk about zero carbon dioxide emissions, that means not emitting any carbon dioxide at all. And then when you hear this, you probably think what most people think, which is, well, how can we actually get to zero human carbon dioxide emissions overall? Surely some things are still going to be emitting a bit. And you're absolutely right. And that's where the net comes in, because there's some sectors, some industries where it'd be very, very difficult, if not impossible, to get them all the way to zero emissions. And so we need some way of offsetting that, some way of absorbing emissions, for example, planting trees, to counteract those emissions. So that's what the net means. It means overall, the balance of all human activities are emitting no carbon dioxide.
Okay, so nature doesn't count, right? You've told me that before. You laughed at me, in fact, for asking that question. So nature doesn't count, but to me, a tree is nature. So how come nature doesn't count, but we can plant trees and that does count?
So I guess nature, when it's in equilibrium, doesn't count, because nature, when it's in equilibrium, is pretty much net zero. It pretty much balances itself out. And you can see this, for example, over the last 10,000 years or so, where CO2 levels have really been super, super stable before we started messing with them. But yeah, if we change nature in some way, which, for example, we do all the time by chopping down trees, then that will create emissions. Or if we change nature in some way by planting a bunch of trees, that could absorb some emissions. So nature, left to its own devices, is net zero by itself. But of course, if we tweak nature in some way, which we have been doing for the past couple of hundred years, then that will change the CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere.
Okay, so if we want to keep doing things that emit, it's like if we want to keep eating cows, we need to come up with some negative emissions somewhere.
Yeah, exactly. I think I haven't heard anyone who really thinks we can get every sector purely to zero on its own, at least with technologies that already exist today. And agriculture is maybe one of the major ones. Major issues. We'd need some way of counteracting that. Now, I think that's very different from saying, oh, let's not bother cutting emissions from all these sectors because maybe we can suck huge amounts of carbon dioxide out the atmosphere. The point of net zero is not, we can just like compensate with loads of negative emissions later. The point is we need to cut as much as we can, and then what we can't cut, we have to find some way of compensating for. But compensating for it is not easy, as any engineer will tell you. Absorbing carbon dioxide is not any easy task. So that really is just for soaking up that last little bit of carbon dioxide that we can't cut.
Yeah, I did just make a video about carbon capture, and it's complicated and expensive. So it's definitely not going to be our first line of defense.
No, I mean, negative emissions, I think, are a really important thing because we need them to reach net zero, but relying on it as if it's going to save the day and solve the problem, absolutely not.
Okay, so next question, are all emissions equal? Because, you know, like I've heard methane is, you know, tens of times worse than carbon dioxide. And then I also only actually recently learned that emissions from aviation count more because they're higher up. I just want to know about the science. Why is there these difference from different sources?
So I guess there are a few different factors that matter. For different gases have different levels of greenhouse effect. Methane is many times more potent as a greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. But there's another factor, and another factor which applies to methane too, which is how long the gas sticks around. So methane sticks around in the atmosphere something like a decade. Carbon dioxide, once it's in the atmosphere and it's kind of stabilized and everything, can be there for hundreds or thousands of years. And then there are all sorts of other things to take into account. For example, aerosols associated with emissions. When we're burning coal, for example, we're kicking up lots of things like black carbon into the atmosphere. So yeah, there are all different kinds of emissions that need to be taken into account. And absolutely, when we think about flying, we need to think about that differently. The impact from flying might be more than twice as big as the impact of the carbon dioxide on its own. All of this complicates things a lot. But for our most ambitious climate change targets, we should be hitting net zero carbon dioxide around the middle of the century. And net zero other greenhouse gases later on in the 20th century.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize that. I thought that because, you know, they always talk about CO2e, and I thought that, you know, like a methane molecule was worth 10 or 20 carbon dioxide ones. But it nearly sounds like you're saying the opposite, because a methane doesn't hang around. It does also seem like methane's going to be the hardest to totally get rid of, because there's a lot of animals out there that are releasing methane no matter what we do.
For this century, a ton of methane is more serious than a ton of carbon dioxide. At the same time, we are emitting so much more carbon dioxide than we are methane that carbon dioxide is definitely the main driving force of climate change this century.
So, yeah, let's talk about the year 2050. As I understand, it's really easy to communicate this concept. Net zero by 2050 is like very, very simple, but there's nothing like magical about the year 2050 though, right? There's a bunch of assumptions that have to be true in order for 2050 to be the year. Can you tell me why it's 2050 and what those assumptions are?
Yeah, sure. So I would say the year 2050, it's somewhat arbitrary. It depends on several different things. The first is that we want to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius. You know, if we go past 1.5 degrees, it's not some precise cutoff. It's not like less than 1.5 degrees is fine. And it's not like worse than 1.5 degrees, the Earth explodes. You know, like climate change is to some extent a continuum of badness. But okay, let's say we do want to keep global temperatures under 1.5 degrees. Well, then if we lowered emissions continuously and the CO2 emissions hit zero around 2050, that would give us a 50-50 chance, basically a coin toss of staying under 1.5 degrees. And it does matter the trajectory we go on to reach that zero.
The Australian Prime Minister recently mentioned that, you know, we don't expect to do a lot of reduction now. Most of it will happen close to 2050 because he says that's how technology works. If we leave it until 2050 and then all of a sudden go to zero, then we've emitted a lot more than if we did all the really easy things now. You know, if we got onto the energy efficiency, electric cars, a lot more renewable electricity. If we did that now, couldn't we buy ourselves some time to do the really hard stuff then at the end? It's the total amount of carbon dioxide that's in the atmosphere that's a problem, right? Not that actually being at net zero isn't the critical thing. It's how much total emissions. Is that right?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. So in your question, you've hinted at two stupid things with that. The first is, yeah, exactly. It's the total amount we've emitted that's a problem. And one of my last videos was actually about this kind of topic, all the stupid things people say to do with net zero. So CO2 in the atmosphere is pretty much like water filling up a glass. So just imagine that tap flowing. If you gradually turn that tap off and then reach zero, you'll fill it up a certain amount. But if you leave it running full stream and then just suddenly turn it off, then your glass is just going to overflow. And that's exactly what would happen with this net zero target. We'll only stay within our carbon budget, that's the phrase, we'll only stay within this carbon budget if we continuously lower our emissions. Continuing as we are and then just stopping would blow us past it and almost guarantee going past 1.5 degrees. So that's the first stupid thing. The second stupid thing, as you also hinted at, is that it doesn't work like that. It's not like, oh, well, if we just leave it later, then it'll just be easier to do everything. Getting to net zero is a hard, continuous process. We need to start work on it. I mean, I would say today, but we needed to start work on it a decade ago. It's a really difficult thing. So yeah, the idea that leaving it later will somehow make it easier, doubly stupid.
Thanks for that conversation, Adam. It is always great to hear your perspective and especially your amazing analogies. So Adam's been a lot more focused on that number zero than I have been. And you can see several other videos about that over on their channel. But it was interesting that they said the path that we take when we make the reduction is even more important. And that it's really much more about how we use our remaining carbon budget more so than hitting net zero on a specific date. Some people think that if we wait long enough, technology is going to make the job easy for us. And I mean, I also think that technology is the main thing that's going to save us. It's going to allow us to avoid catastrophic climate change. But waiting is going to make the job harder, not easier. If we wait 20 years for green technologies to develop a bit more, we'll have blown through our carbon budget well before then. And as a result, we're going to have to do a lot more of the really hard stuff a lot earlier. So that will mean, for example, negative emissions in order to avoid overshooting our temperature goal. And in contrast, if we do all the easy and cheap things now, like energy efficiency, renewable electricity, and then electrifying all the easy things to electrify, like transport, if we do all that as fast as possible, then we have much more carbon left in the budget to take time we need to develop technologies to solve the hard stuff. Hard things like aviation, shipping, cement, for example. I want to thank Adam for this video collaboration. It was really nice to kind of think big and get a bit philosophical for a change. Don't forget to check out the other video we made over on Climate Adam and subscribe while you're there. For more on clean energy technologies, then check out the other videos on my channel. And if you want to help this channel develop, then you might like to join the Engineering with Rosie Patreon community. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.